Last week, we spoke about how church is not just a building or some places that we come to, but church is us, the people, the body of Christ. So I would like to invite everybody right now, let's stand to our feet and let's worship the God, the body that we are a part of. Let's just open our minds, let's open our hearts, let's avail ourselves to the Holy Spirit to move within us. Amen. Let's just pray. Father God, we just thank you for this morning. We thank you that we are able to get up this today, that we're healthy and well, Lord Jesus, and that your presence is here, God, and that you continue to move in our lives, Lord. We bless this service. We bless everybody that came here, Father, Lord. I thank you for every individual person here, God. Lord, I pray that you would speak to their hearts. Lord God, that let your spirit move. Lord Jesus, that the word that is spoken today, God, that it may be applied in our lives, that it would change our hearts and that it would change our ways, God. Lord, we just want to worship you this morning. We want to praise you today, God, for who you are in our lives and how great and awesome you are, God. We just give you all the glory. We give you all the honor and praise. Amen.
Standing here in your presence, thinking of all the good.
Standing here in your presence, thinking of the good things you have done. Waiting here patiently, just to hear your still small voice again. Holy, righteous, faithful to the end, Savior. You for who you are, I will worship you for who you are.
Let's give Jesus a clap offering. He is so worthy.
Wow. It's good to see everybody again. Right now, we're going to bring our tithes, our offerings to the Lord. You know, just wanted to quickly mention, there are in our body, right? We have our heart, we have our arms and legs and things like that. Just like in our body, in the body of Christ, there are those people that are able to go out, that are able to serve as the hands and feet of Christ, that are able to be as missionaries, that serve in other ministries. And there are those that are unable to do those kind of things. And with our finances, we are like those blood vessels that supply the materials and things like that, so the word of God may be spread, so that the word of God may be poured out into children, that the word of God may be spread to our communities. And as of right now, so our tithes is something that we bring to God, the 10% that we have come accustomed to, not just as a tradition, but as we've been taught to. But let's also bring and think about the additional offering that we can bring to serve those others, to serve those people and help those folks that go out to bring the word of Christ to our children and to the communities. So let's just, in this also, we're going to pray for our children as they go to kids' church. So let's just lift up our hands. Let's lift up what we brought to God today, and let's just thank Him for what He has blessed us with, and that we'd be able to bless others with what He has given us. Lord, we thank You so much, God, that You are our provider, that You are our supplier. Lord God, that all our being and that everything that we have, it comes from You, Jesus. Lord, we thank You for that we are able to serve others with what You have blessed us with. Lord, I pray, Lord Jesus, that just this would not be a service of routine or tradition, God, but that our hearts may be opened for more. Lord Jesus, that we'd be able to see more, that we would be able to be Your hands and feet. Lord God, and if we are not able to go somewhere, God, that we may be able to still support and supply and help reach those people, Lord God. Lord, this morning we just open ourselves, God. Lord, we surrender everything to You, Jesus, Lord. Right now we open up our hearts, Lord God, in worship. Lord, let Your Spirit just break out in this place, God. Lord, we bless the children, Lord God, as they go to kids' church to learn about Your word, to learn how to interact with each other, God, to learn how to serve Your people, to learn how to be the light in this dark world, God. Lord, we bless them in Your name. We just give them up into Your hands, God. Lord, from out of Your hand, nobody can peck out. Lord, we thank You for everything, Jesus, Lord, and we just worship You this morning. Lord, let Your Spirit break out in this place. Let Your Spirit flow. God, let Your Spirit flow through everybody's heart, Lord God. Let Your Spirit move, Jesus. We proclaim Your kingdom here, Your deliverance, Your salvation, God, Your healing, Your power, Your provision, Jesus. We just invite You here this morning, God. Lord, in everything, we thank You. Amen. So at this time, kids can go to kids' church.
All of heaven knows Your name. Sing louder. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching God. Your glory shaking. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break.
Hallelujah, Lord God. We thank you and we glorify you, Lord God. For you alone are good. And we thank you, Lord God. We glorify you, Lord God. For you alone are holy. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We thank you and glorify you, Lord God, for this incredible day that you have given us. And like your word says, that I will rejoice and I will be glad in it. I thank you, Lord God, for everybody that has come here, Lord God, that we have come here as a community, that we have come here as a body, that we have come together as a church, Lord. I thank you, Lord God, that we have given the honor to give you praise, that we are given the honor of glorifying your holy name, Lord God. I pray for everyone in this place, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would go and begin to stir up their hearts, that you would begin to stir up the dry things in their lives, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you are going to go amongst this place, Lord God. And I pray that you're going to touch every single one in this place, Lord God. Because we're all going through different things. We're all going through different seasons. But I pray, Lord God, that you would come in this place. That I pray, Lord God, that you're going to come and bring joy into the places that we have been defeated or where we have doubt and fear, Lord. But I pray that your Holy Spirit is going to come and comfort us. He's going to come and encourage us. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come and touch every heart in this place, Lord God. I pray, like your word says, that we would open our ears to hear, open our minds to understand, that we would transform our minds, open up our hearts to receive from you, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you would open up the bitter hearts, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, like your word says, that you would send your ministering angels into this place, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, that you sent your Son, Lord God, to take our place on the cross. I thank you, Lord God, for the resurrection power that we have. Hallelujah, Lord, we thank you. We exalt your holy name in this place. Psalms 91. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I will trust. My God in whom I will trust. How many can we say that today, that he is my God and in him I will trust? I'm not going to trust in the things of this world, but in my God I will trust. And so that's why right now, I want everybody to just raise your hands. Begin to pray, continue to cry out to God. The things that are happening in this world, it comes to a place where we can't depend on anything else. With everything crashing, with fear and doubt creeping in. So let's raise our hands, and as they sing, just completely come before God and pray these things. Thank you, Lord God, and I glorify you. I thank you, Lord God, for you are good, that you are just, Lord God. I thank you for the love that you have given us, Lord God, that abounds in us, Lord God. And your word says that you want to abide in your people. And I pray, Lord God, that we will learn to come into your presence, that we will learn to come before you, Lord God, because you're not going to invade, you're not going to force yourself into our lives. But I pray, Lord God, that we will take it and learn how to practice and how to come into the presence of God. I pray, Lord God, that we learn to apply ourselves, that we learn to come before our knees before you, Lord God, and only then you will move. I pray, Lord God, that we learn these things, that we learn to come before you, Lord God, that we learn how to pray, how to seek your face, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, and I could give you praise and glory forever. that you have given us this great honor to worship you. Hallelujah. Amen. You guys could all be seated. Praise God. Thank you, worship team. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm glad that you're here. Amen. I want to share really quickly, and then afterwards, I really want to pray. Because I believe that what we do in this place, if it doesn't affect our tomorrow, if what we do, like one pastor said, if what we do on Sunday doesn't affect our Monday, we're just wasting time. Amen. And so that's why I really want to come and pray with you guys. Because I understand that you can speak a lot of lectures, you can speak a lot of things, but when it doesn't come to practical things, when it doesn't come to people actually being changed, where people's lives are transformed, then it's just a good sermon. Amen. Amen. So I'm really glad to be here in this place. I'm really glad for this church. I'm really glad that they made an opportunity where I could speak in English, and it's really hard for me to speak in Russian and preach in Russian with an interpreter. But I'm really glad that we have an English service finally, and our church can come together. Amen. And so I want to speak on a few things. I really want to get into the thing because we don't have much time. The thing I want to talk about is the Jewish temple. The Jewish temple that was built twice and has been destroyed. When you look at the things of the Jewish temple, you have three parts or three aspects to the Jewish temple. You have the outer courts, you have the inner courts, and then you have the Holy of Holies, correct? And so just to break it down, the outer courts was just a general place for the public. It was a place where they had all the people would gather. That's where a lot of the business was conducted. That's where you would have people come in and they would trade the Roman coin for the tax coin. It was a place of business where they would sell the sheep and the goats and things for the sacrifice. It was a place of business. That's why when you read in the Bible where Jesus got offended, he did it in the outer courts. That's where he said, you know, what you're doing, you've turned the temple of God into a marketplace. And then we see the inner courts. That was a place where the priests would come in. And essentially, there were people that would follow the law, correct? The priests would come, they would do everything that the law would require of them. And that's why they would do everything that the law would say. You know, do this and do this, follow all these laws. And they were the priests. And then you see the Holy of Holies. It was a place that was very sacred. The Bible even says it was the actual dwelling place of God. And that's why every year, Yom Kippur, it was the Day of Atonement where the high priest would be able to go into that place. And they say they would have to do many, many rituals of purification where he had to be so pure, where he had to be completely without sin in order to go into that place. Only once in a year he was able to do that. And that's why just this whole message, I want to talk about those three aspects and how, where do you find yourself in these three places? Do you find yourself in the outer courts where the general public is, the general place of the world is, where the people of the world are? Do you find yourself in the inner courts, the place where you abide by God's law, where you follow God's law, where you follow God's decree? You live by good works, you've done everything correctly, or are you able to come into the Holy of Holies? And so you could even reflect and begin to ask yourself, where do you find yourself in those three places? Because the Bible says that because through Jesus Christ, we have been atoned for, that through Jesus Christ, our sins are now forgiven, and now we can go into the Holy of Holies. Amen? That now we can go into the very presence of God because we are all without sin, right? Through Jesus Christ. That all our sins have been atoned for, that now the Bible says that we are without blemish, without blame, that now it's his righteousness that covers us. And since we can do that, since we can go into the presence of God, how come it's so rare that people really do? Why is it so rare that people actually live out that lifestyle? And I want to talk about two stories in the Bible. One of them, if people don't know me that well, is my favorite, is Egypt, the Israelites coming out of Egypt. I like to speak on that many times. But when you have the Israelites, when they're coming out of Egypt, in a sense, that was them coming out of the outer courts. where they were coming out of the general place and they were going into a place where they would walk in the desert. And you have so many people that would say, we have to be aware of the presence of God. We have to be aware of the things of God. And that's why you see the Israelites, when they were in the desert, when they were walking in the desert, they experienced the things of God, correct? They saw the pillar of fire by night. They saw the cloud going with them by day. They saw the manna coming from heaven. Isn't that not a miracle? Could you imagine bread falling from the sky right now? That's amazing. I don't know about you. And so they would experience all these things. They would experience water coming out of a rock. They would see quail coming because they desired for meat. And you see all these different things, all these miracles of God. But that was still the inner courts. That was not the Holy of Holies. God wanted them to go into the Holy of Holies. But then we find so many people that say, wow, you know, this place is really great. I experience the things of God. I see how God still blesses me. I see how God still provides for me, even though I'm in the desert, even though I'm in the inner courts. But God never wanted us to be in the inner courts. The Bible says that He wanted to abide in us and for the people to abide in Him, correct? That's why He sent His Son, because He was tired of the temple where, you know, there was still that separation. Because before, in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, He wanted that relationship again with us, where we would come and we would dwell with God every day, where we would walk with Him, we would spend time with Him. But because of sin, that was separated. And so that's why you had the temple, but now we have Jesus Christ. And so now that relationship, that status has been returned back to us, where now we could dwell with God again. But then you see, a lot of people don't. A lot of people still really focus on being in the inner courts, where they say, because could you imagine, I know that it's really hard for us to go into the Holy of Holies, because out of nowhere, it's like you've been saved through grace, and it's by your faith, and you think that's impossible. And one of the people, when I minister to people, that's always the hardest thing that they have to overcome. They think, I've done bad things, I've done very nasty things, sinful things, and now you're telling me because I received Jesus Christ, now I could go into the Holy of Holies. And that's what the Bible says, that you receive Jesus Christ, and now you are clean. And it's that simple. But many people say, it can't be that simple. I have to go through a process. I have to go through purification. I have to die to my sins. Like, all those things are good for your character. But right away, as soon as you receive Christ, if you die, you're going to heaven, correct? But many people think it can't be that simple. And so that's why they believe it's through good works. I have to do good things. I have to do good things in order to appease God, in order to please God. And then I could finally go into the Holy of Holies. After 10 years of edification, of reading the Bible, after reading the Bible multiple times, and then we feel like I'm holy enough to go into the Holy of Holies. But God says, you don't make yourself holy. I make yourself holy. It's not your righteousness that makes you righteous. It is my righteousness. The righteousness of God that makes you righteous. Amen? And so that's why I understand why people want to dwell in the Holy of Holies, in the inner courts, because it is much easier, because Allah is not required from them, correct? Because when you're in the inner courts, it's so easy. All you have to do is just follow the law. But then when you go into the Holy of Holies, I like how Apostle Paul says in Colossians, when he says, Apostle Paul, directed by the will of God. And I always wondered myself, what did he mean by that? What does he mean, directed or called by the will of God? And then I was wondering that so many people have a different will for your life. I have a different will that I've always had in my life. My parents have a will that they want me to fulfill. But then I was always wondering, what will does God have for me? And then I was always wondering, what if people are afraid to know the will that God has placed over their lives? And I know many of us are young, and I know that many times I feel like that people are afraid of going into the Holy of Holies because they're afraid of what is going to be required of them. And I believe people are afraid of the sacrifice that's going to be required. And I think that people are afraid of what's going to happen in the Holy of Holies. And that's why so many people, I know, you could even ask yourself, when you came before God and you planned out your whole life, did you really pray it out? Did you really come before God and say, God, show me the vision, show me the calling you have for my life? Or did you say, God, I am doing this, can you please approve it? Can you please bless what I have planned for my life? And so many times you see that people are afraid to approach the Holy of Holies because they're afraid of what is going to be required of them. And that's why the second story I want to share with you is when Jesus was walking, and then the Bible says that 5,000 people came to hear him speak. There's just 5,000 men, but with women and children, it's estimated that there's 20,000 people in front of him. And he's saying this great sermon, and then he says, you know, give them food to eat. And so God gives them food. And that's why I feel like there's so many people that walk in that manner with God, where they say, I want to follow you because I love to hear what you have to say. I want to follow you because I love to receive from you. I love to follow you because you're going to give me fish. I love because you're going to, because, you know, the Bible, it says that with two fish and five loaves, he fed 5,000 men. And so that's why we love receiving. We love taking and receiving and receiving. But then it comes to a point where we have to learn that we have to give back to God, where now we have to sacrifice things and give it back to God. Amen? And many times we're afraid of doing those things. We're afraid of coming into the holy place because now we're afraid of what's going to be required of us. Because I feel like many people don't want to go deep and intimate before God because they're afraid of what's going to be asked of them. And I really believe that we as a church, we have to step into that place. Because you see, the Egyptians, when they stepped into the promised land, it wasn't 100 of them. It was everybody. 2 million Israelites walked into the promised land. It was a corporate event. It was a corporate movement where they stepped into and went into the promised land. And that's why you see that once they stepped into the promised land, there was a lot of things required of them. Where you see that when they were in the inner courts, when they were in the desert, everything was given to them, right? The manna, the fire, the cloud, everything was given to them. All they didn't have to do anything except be led. But then when they went into the promised land, they had to build up their city. They had to defend the surrounding enemies. They had to go and they had to fight and defeat Jericho. And many times people think, I want to stay in the desert because it's easy. Because I like staying here. I like receiving. I like just walking with God and spending time with God. But then God says there comes a point where you have to go into the Holy of Holies, where you have to go into the promised land, where now you have to carry your cross. I like how one pastor said that you can't carry the cross and still do sinful things with your hands. Amen. And so that's why, like these people, you see 20,000 people came after God for the things of God. But then only 12 truly wanted to spend time with him, where they spent every single time with him, where they spent a lot of time with him. And then you even see that the way they ended their lives or the way their lives ended were very similar to the things of that their lives ended like Christ. And I'm not saying I want everybody to die right now and become martyrs and missionaries. That's not what I'm preaching here. I'm saying that I want people here to become more serious with their faith, with their walk in Christ. I want people to take this very serious and understand that there is more that God requires of us, that wants from us. He doesn't just want to lead by you. I understand there's a process where that happens, where God continues to lead you, where he continues to give you things and show you things. But there comes a process where we begin to fight for these things then. Amen? When the people went to the promised land, there was already people there. They're already surrounded by their enemies. And that was the thing they had to do with God on their side. But they had to physically go and fight. They had to physically go and build up. And that's what's really required of us. If we expect that we're just going to sit here and pray for revival, revival's not going to come. It's only when we begin to apply ourselves. And I like how one pastor said that revival is only going to come when the older and the younger generation are going to begin to work together. And that's what we have to do. We have to really come together in a corporate place, in a corporate time. And like Pastor was speaking on the church previously, and that applies for the church, where we don't come to a place where we just want to sit down and receive a good message or want to hear a good worship song. But a church is a place where you become involved. It's a place where you have to be transparent. It's a place where you have to be involved and continue to grow and edify the church in order that all of us together could begin to walk into the promised land. And that's why it's necessary for us to pray for one another. It's necessary for us to lift each other up. Because all of us are not going to be on a spiritual high. And that's why I surround myself with godly people. Because I know life is hard. People always pray for me. I come before people and they pray for me. I want to ask yourself, when was the last time somebody even prayed for you? You know, and as a body, it should be a normal thing where we come together and pray for one another, encourage one another. Because if we think that we're going to be doing all this on our own, we're going to fail. Because we have to all move together as a corporate, as a church, into the next phase, into the next season that God has called for us. And so that's why as a church, I believe that God is really requiring more of us, especially since we're living in the last days, especially in the time that we live now, that no longer can we just receive. It comes a point in our spiritual growth where now we have to pick up the sword and begin to fight and begin to stand up and encourage one another. There are times in the Bible where you saw David, when he was fighting the giants, he was able to defeat the giant. And later in his life, there was a time where a giant almost killed him, but his brother came and helped him defeat that giant. And I believe that we have to do that for each other, that there are days where we're strong, we're powerful through Christ, and we're able to defeat our sins, we're able to overcome temptation, but there are other days where we're overcome with doubt, we're overcome with fear, we're overcome with trials, and there is necessary for people to be around us in order to uplift us and help us. And so right now, I want to encourage ask the worship team to come forward. I want to sing one more song, and what I really want to do is, I really want to pray for people. I really want people to be accustomed to coming to the front, because I know it's almost like this Slavic mentality that every time you come to the front, you're a great sinner, you killed somebody, and now you need repentance. But I want people to be comfortable coming to the front, receiving prayer. There are times, so many times, where I receive prayer because I need to. There's life, you know, a lot of things in life happen, and I need to receive prayer because I'll be going through a hard time. Like I know Andrew Womack always says that if you're not being attacked by the enemy, maybe you're going in the same direction. And that's why if you're not being attacked, maybe it's because there's nothing to attack. There's no reason to attack you. But if you're strong in the Lord, know that there's going to be opposition. Know that things are going to come against you. The devil wants to come against you, wants you to stumble, wants you to fall. And so that's why I encourage us. I want us as a church to be accustomed to praying for one another, coming together in prayer and truly praying for one another. That's what a church does. A church isn't a place where we just come together and just sing songs. A church is a place where we edify one another. And so that's why if anyone needs prayer for healing, needs prayer just for encouragement, needs prayer because they're going through a hard time, or even repentance, that's fine. I really want to encourage people to come forward and just pray, because I know that it's through prayer. It's because that's the only reason I'm standing here today, is because I was at a low point in my life, and I came before people, and they prayed for me. And I know that really helped me go into the next season. It really helped me stand back on my feet, because there are times where we are overcome by so much in this world, you know, by evil spirits and demonic oppression. And those things many times are hard for us to just shake off and get past. Those things we really need prayer for. And so let us all stand. And as they sing this song, even reflect your own life. Where are you in this scenario, in the temple? Are you at a place where you're still in the outer courts, where you're with the general public? Or are you in the inner courts where you think, I'm just going to live life. I love receiving. I love getting things and receiving things of God. But no, there's a time where you have to go into the next season. That there's a time where you receive from God, but then there's a time where you help others come into the presence of God. And so in this time, if anyone needs prayer, our pastor and our leaders would really pray for you, to help you with whatever is going on, if that's even physical healing, if that's just spiritual encouragement. So that's why just begin to reflect, begin to even pray. Because know the things of God, you have to go and you have to take those things. That if you want deliverance, it won't just come by you standing. Those things you have to come and you have to apply, you have to pray. Thank you. Lord God, we thank you and we glorify you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you have called us, that you have called us your people, and that we are privileged to call you our God. I thank you, Lord God, that amongst the storms, amongst the winds, we can be still and know that you are God. I thank you, Lord God, that you have called us to a life of victory, to live a victorious life, Lord God, that you have called us to live a life of righteousness, your righteousness. And like it says in Matthew 6:33, to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else would be added on or accounted for. I thank you, Lord God, that we are able to come into your presence. I thank you, Lord God, that in your presence is the fullness of your joy. I pray, Lord God, and I speak joy into the people here. I pray, Lord God, and speak happiness and joy and a cheerful heart into these people, Lord God. I rebuke, Lord God, the things that were stolen away from them from the enemy, Lord. And I pray that that will be restored back to them. I rebuke any spirit of shame over this place in the name of Jesus. I rebuke every spirit of neglect in the name of Jesus, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you would restore the broken families. I pray, Lord, that you would restore the broken lives in this place, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you would restore your church again. I pray, Lord God, that we be a church, Lord God, that moves by your spirit, Lord. I pray, Lord God, that we be a church that people would come and be delivered, a church where people come and be changed. I pray, Lord God, for great things for this church, Lord God, because it is your church. And your word says that the church that you have built, the gates of hell will not prevail, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that this is your church that you have called to be in this time. And I pray, Lord God, that out of this place that you're going to call up your leaders, that from this place that you're going to call your mighty men, that you're going to call your mighty women out of this place, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that you are going to raise us up, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, and I speak boldness into this place. I speak boldness into all these people here, Lord God. For your word says that it's not by power or by might, but it's by my spirit. And I pray, Lord God, that we'll be led by your spirit, that we'll be filled with your spirit. Because Galatians 5 says that the things of the spirit are contrary to the things of this world. So if you're suffering with or having a hard time dealing or getting away from the world, be filled with the spirit. And that's why the things of this world will not even appeal to you anymore. And the things of this world are contrary to the things of the Spirit. And so that's why I encourage you to be filled with the Spirit. And you'll be living a victorious life. And Lord God, we thank you, we honor you for the people that have come. We thank you for your Spirit. We thank you, Lord God, that we were able to worship you, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, that we could dwell in your presence. That we could hide under your wings, Lord God. That you comfort us, that you love us, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, and I bless everyone in this place, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, that they would be transformed, that what happens here, Lord God, would be carried out into Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, that they live a life of victory. We thank you, we honor you. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. Amen.
What a good word. What a good prayer. Thank you all for coming. We are happy that everybody's here today. And I want to make a quick announcement. Before we go, we have our annual Christmas concert coming up December 20th. And it's a big event. There's going to be a banquet after. However, spaces are becoming very, very, very limited and very quickly. So if you have friends or people that you would like to invite to this event, they have to register. We have invitations. If you can give them an invitation, there's a phone number that they can call. There's a website that you can go to and register. It's free, so in case somebody's wondering. But if space runs out, everybody's able to make to the concert. However, to the banquet, there's set amount of spaces. So please be mindful. And there's been a little over 100 people already signed up. Yeah, so spaces are running out quickly. It's gonna be great. It's really awesome. There's going to be gifts for kids. So just be mindful. And it's for everybody. So elders, young folks, whoever, it doesn't matter the age. So it's going to be awesome. And also, this concludes our service for today. The cafe is open. You're welcome to go through these doors. There's coffee and whatever else good stuff that they have prepared. So thank you all for coming. be blessed. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. All right. Have a good one.